Hello everybody, this is Julio Morales again, International Ventures Group, and I took the time just to put together a short little PowerPoint here about the COVID-19 the United States regarding the financial status of this country, and also I had little snippets of statistics from other countries economically, most importantly. And how we have dealt with it here in the U.S. Again, we're talking about strictly financial standpoints. There is some statistical standpoint as well, but for the most part, I wanted to keep this as much economical as possible. So, of course, as you can see, you see the Statue of Liberty there saying we're closed. That's very much what happened here in most countries, is we pretty much just took one big giant switch and turned it off. It's not like 08 or other recessions that we had in the past, or downtimes that we've had in the past. We literally shut everything off. We closed off the valve. And of course, I'm sure you know by now that the United States has the highest confirmed cases, death, despite being only the third largest country in the world. However, when you look at the average per population, United States is only ninth in the world in regards to the cases and the deaths regarding COVID-19. And I want everyone watching to know that this statistics was taken within the last week. Pretty much everything is off the CDC and the WHO, the World Health Organization, and the Center for Disease Control here in the U.S. And you can see on average, actually, we're nowhere near the top. That's actually gone down, I believe, in this. We are ninth on average per population. You can see the top countries are all European countries, Belgium, Spain, Italy, the U.K., France, Sweden, Netherlands, Ireland. Even behind us, you have countries such as Switzerland and Portugal. And some of you may know how Europe was not too hot before all of this. Obviously, they have their negative rates over there. Countries planning to leave the Eurozone. Brexit obviously being a big factor over there as well. And here in the U.S., we've definitely treated the approach differently depending on what state you've lived in. Some of the states never closed at all, where some states and metropolitans, most notably the New York City one, you couldn't even walk within a block radius going outside. And of course, you can only leave for essentials. So we definitely didn't paint the country with one broad brush as far as the restrictions, the stay-at-home policies. And you can see here, this is a pretty decent map of, again, this is all taken within last week, so some of this changed. I can speak for here in Florida, we're pretty much all open except for theme parks and stadiums, areas of mass gatherings for entertainment, you know, movie theaters. But gyms, restaurants, all the stores, all the shops, for the most part, granted, I live on the West Coast. Miami is about 2 weeks behind us as far as that. And we've been doing that since the beginning of May. So almost a month now. It's pretty interesting. As you can see, Utah, Wyoming, South Dakota, I believe Arkansas, and they never did anything regarding this. No stay-at-home order whatsoever. And of course, this actually shows we've been very fortunate here in Florida. We are the third largest in the U.S. We did pass the state of New York within the last couple of years. We have 21 million people living in the state of Florida. And not only that, one out of every 20 Floridian is originally from New York. And of course, we have a fair share of what we call snowbirds, transplants that move down here from the Midwest, New England, the Northeast, pretty much everywhere. We are a melting pot of the 50 states. Despite being third in population, and we have the sixth largest and third densest metropolitan being Miami, Florida is only the 27th in the country per population regarding COVID deaths and cases. So we have been, like I said, very fortunate, and we have gotten a lot of praise in how we have handled things down here. But one thing I can speak on a fundamental standpoint is, for the most part, everything remained open. The essentials, restaurants did close, gyms closed, and essentials stayed open, and were very quickly to reopen them at a safe pace, of course. Now we're going to dig down to a little bit of the economics of this. Don't fight the Fed. Despite the highest unemployment ever in the United States, 14%. If you dig a little deeper, yes, only I believe it's close to the 10% of the 14% are on temporary layoff. So it is significantly lower than that when you dig deep into the numbers. The financial markets are looking very forward. They look towards the future. For example, financial markets started going down in the beginning of February, long before they had any single closures here in the U.S. And they started going up in the end of March, long before anything opened up or considered opening up the states that did have a stay at home. So obviously we see here the S&P 500 dropping over a month before the closure. And one of the biggest reasons I believe that it went up from a fundamental standpoint is the Federal Reserve dropping the rate to 0%. And the Federal Reserve has thrown, including, as we say, everything but the kitchen sink. They threw the kitchen sink at this. They threw the whole kitchen at this problem, either through the SBA PPP or the Main Street funding program, really aiming to help the small businesses in this country that do not have the capital markets to fall back on for all the missed revenue they were not going to get. Also, regarding of all the G20 countries, the U.S. is second when it comes to stimulus per GDP. It's a very important number. You might have read the headlines, India vowed to put 10% of stimulus per GDP. The United States is only second to Japan, and Japan is noticeably they've had a lot of stagnation in the last decade. They do not want this to nip them in the butt. All right, this also backs into the fundamental standpoint: do not fight the Fed. What you're looking at right now is the S&P 500 going all the way back to 1950 and to the left. On the right, you're looking at the federal funds rate, where I was talking about that they dropped to zero. Now, as you can see, the S&P 500 has been going up pretty much since the beginning of time. And you can see the first drop, major drop there, as you can see, in a little bit after 2000, 2001, we did have a downturn in the financial markets. They call it a tech bubble. It didn't really affect. Most people weren't even aware of it. And then, of course, the second big drop there is 2008. And that big upswing you see then is after 2008. On the right, you have the Fed funds rate going back to 1954, I believe. And, of course, you can see that high point, 19.1, that is the beginning of the 80s. As they call it, that is when we had a lot of inflationary issues, the inflationary 70s, as they called it. And of course, you've seen it go down and down and down, and you see that big drop there in 07. That is when, 07, 08, that is when, of course, the financial crisis happened. And even slightly before then, after 99, 2000, that's when the tech bubble happened. And so you're starting to see a trend here, a cycle of the dropping of the Fed rates every 8 years, because we go through some sort of a recession every 8 years. Now, obviously, this one has prolonged 10 years. So, or at least close to that. So as you can see, we had zero Fed fund rates from 2008 till, and I remember this very vividly, December 2015. And it stayed like that again until November 2016, or I'm sorry, a year later, December 2016. Of course, it was a month after the elections here in 2016. And it's been climbing ever since. And if you look on the left, the stock market continued to climb at that time as well, despite rates going up. Because rates going up usually are negative against the stock market, financial markets overall, because it's more expensive for money to be borrowed. So as you can see, every time it goes down, the market goes up. And as you can see, right now we're at zero practically. So of course, where is the financial markets going to go? Up. And of course, they are very forward looking. They see the light at the end of the tunnel. People are going back to work. Economies are opening up again. I typed this up the other day, and we're much more closer than 50 to 65% at the moment. The NASDAQ is within a couple of points of the all-time high right now. All right, the American dollar. This is one of the most important charts because, as you can see, it did take a dip when the financial markets went down. Why everything went down is because everyone was going into cash. And what happened when cash came back into the markets? People bought dollars. Not only here in the US, but it's very important for people to know this. People selling their euros, selling their pounds, selling their Japanese yens, selling their Swiss francs. You name the currency, they were selling it, they were buying dollars. So rest assured, people worry about inflation because of all the money that we're printing here in the US. Well, they are buying these dollars. Best believe they are buying them. And as you can see, the dollar has only gotten stronger because of all this, because people do have faith in our economy over their own. On top of us Americans buying dollars, people international buy dollars as well. And it's been, you can see it was already on an uptick before all this, and it's continued that trend even more so, even stronger than after this. All right, this is a little email I remember putting together back at the end of March, telling people what sectors to look at. So, you know, if you want to call my bluff, if you will, I did inform people end of March to look into these sectors. These are as hard as hit: airlines, hotels, energy companies. We all know oil went to negative, and they all will go back up. I did pick Boeing as a good stock. Well, one thing I did add to my portfolio recently is Disney. Their theme park's going to open up again. I got Disney at a steal at $99. Boeing, I got at $125. Most of those oil energy sector ETFs, I got them for $5, around that range. The energy company ETFs are about $20. Most of those on the screen right now, with the exception of Delta and Boeing, have doubled. So that just goes to show you. And these are beaten down sectors. These are the dogs. These are the areas that are going to get hurt the most, or already hurt the most. So as you can see, at the moment, S&P had lost 25% of the low overall weighting. It did lose only a year and a half of gains during all this. And we're already close to, we're knocking on the door again of the all-time highs here pretty soon. Now, commercial funding. Just goes to, you know, one of my fortes, financial markets and the capital raising markets. For the most part, we are open for business here in the United States, with only a handful of funding sources no longer taking principals. Mainly, they have only been stricter in certain sectors, such as hospitality, restaurants. Many of the prospects of these sectors are now focusing on similar projects in states that are open or opening. I had some people that had some projects in a closed state, a state that announced that they were not going to open till August. They've obviously changed that. A lot of the states have you know, pushed forward their opening days, and they started looking at, you know, companies in states that are already open. The SBA program has been a lifesaver, not only for me, but many of my principals and clients. And I can speak for, you know, it's going to end up being saving hundreds of thousands of jobs and careers and businesses, small businesses here in the U.S., the SBA program, either through PPP or just the program overall. It has slowed down, it has been bogged down, but it has been a lifesaver. You're able to get principal 90% LTV, some of the lowest rates allowed by the Federal Reserve. It's, you know, long story short, SBA is insurance for any funder. Meaning if you don't pay them back, the government pays them back. So they're able to get a much higher rate, LTV with really low rates because of it. So yes, a lot of people are getting new loans, a lot of people refinancing, keep the business going or start a new business because of the new rates. So it's been a long, slow, meticulous time for the SBA, but it is moving along. Two months ago, no one knew what the future held. It is always the darkest before the light. But today, the measures in place, the U.S. is opening up at a safe pace. There will be obstacles in the way, for sure, but this country has been through worse. The perseverance of the people will bring them through as it always has. I'd like to take this time and hope everyone is doing well. And their loved ones are safe and healthy through all of this. Anyone in my network out there, and God bless the USA and bless you guys as well. Thank you for your time.